Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. My name is Alyssa Devlich, and I work for Sony AI as a senior research scientist. And I'm very happy today to share with you our story on journey about designing a superhuman racing AI agent using deep reinforcement learning that was able to overtake the best GT drivers in the world and then take on the next tech quest of training a fun opponent GT Sophie agent that was able to play against players of different racing skills in the world, making it a permanent edition of GT7 game on PlayStation 5. And let's start. So this is the team that was actually working on our first grand challenge of designing a superhuman AI agent. And we are, of course, a bigger team today. Our organization is very young and very international. We were established in April 2020. Sony AI has a remote workforce in North America, and it has physical offices in Tokyo, Zurich, and recently Barcelona. We have four flagship projects, imaging and sensing, gastronomy, AI ethics, and gaming, that you can read more on our website. And this project in particular was in the partnership with Polyphony Digital, which is a vendor of Gran Turismo game, and Sony Interactive Entertainment, that was a vendor of cloud gaming infrastructure and, of course, owner of the PlayStation. So Gran Turismo is more than just a video game. It is one of the world's most complete driving simulator, modeling the complex physics in automobile racing. Driving in Gran Turismo is a precision operation, and even the smallest high-speed mistake can lead to a catastrophic spin. This talk will be split into two parts. First part will be about building our research outcome, the superhuman racing agent, and the second will be about how we turned this research outcome into the real product. So GT Sophie was featured on the February 10th issue of Nature after outracing four of the best GT drivers in the world on three different car track combinations. And it took us less than actually 2 years to basically productize it and make it a permanent addition to the GT7 game on PlayStation, which happened in November 2023. For our grand challenge, we had two races. One was in July and another in October 2021. And we had four of our GT Sophie agents racing against four of the top GT drivers, which are shown in the bottom of this slide, on three track car combinations. The first track, Dragon Trail Seaside, used a high-performance road vehicle. On the second track, Lago Maggiore, the vehicle was equivalent to the Federation International Automobile GT3 class of race cars. The third and final track took place on Circuit de la Sarthe, which was also famous as the home of the 24 Hours of La Manche. This race featured the Red Bull X 2019 car that was able to exceed the speeds of 300 kilometers per hour. Points were awarded for every position, with the double points on the final track that was actually the most complex one. So here's a short teaser to give you a feeling what we worked on in the first 2 years.
There's very few places where you can go out and say, I'm going to build an AI, and I'm going to make it truly superhuman.
To create artificial intelligence that will unleash the power of the human creativity and imagination.
Gran Turismo and Sophie is a super exciting project. It's an amazing AI research and development activity.
There are many racing games where the physics is half done, but in Gran Turismo, that racing sensation that the players get, that's really at the core of the game.
この、なんか車文化、車という存在をもう丸ごとビデオゲームの中にこう再現したいなと思ったんですね。Because
of the realism of the game, it is actually very difficult to program agents.
We spent a lot of time trying to figure out what things we needed to change in order to get that superhuman performance.
Why are we building this GT Sophie agent?
This is not just a technical breakthrough project. It really is about bringing AI into the hands of the game developers who are going to build the new experiences for the players.
本当にすごいアグレッシブで、これからもっと一緒にレースしていきたいなっていうふうに思いましたね。
And there was a full movie to watch on our website. So we had to first identify what are the challenges to solve here. The first challenge was about racing car control. So to basically teach an agent how to handle the car dynamics, how to understand the complex physics about making an agent that can be as competitive as these top driving cars. So how to drive as fast as possible. The second is about racing tactics, understanding how and when to pass the opponents without actually colliding them, and master the techniques like slipstream passes, making a crossover pass, and even some defensive maneuvers like blocking. And the third and last one is about racing etiquette, how to actually be a fair play and do not cause collisions with other opponents. We had to train our agent and the computing infrastructure at scale, so most particularly with the PlayStations in the clouds. And we had the help of Sony Interactive Entertainment that actually provided us with this architecture at scale, which had like thousands of PlayStations in the cloud. Game basically ran on PlayStations only, so we had to claim an instance of PlayStation for every game that we wanted to train our agent with. The agent has run on the separate computer in the form of these rollout workers that actually collected experiences of the state's actions and rewards. They collected these experiences and sent it to a centralized trainer. The trainer then stored these experiences in the experience replay buffer that was trained with an algorithm called QRSEC, quantile regression, soft after critic, and that then updated the policies with all this new information. When the policies were updated, it sent those policies back to the rollout workers, which then switched the policies and then continued collecting the new experiences with these policies. The typical agent was trained with 20 PlayStations, 20 rollout workers, and one trainer, which then collected and updated these policies. So we trained the agent with reinforcement learning, which I'm sure you are all familiar with. But just briefly, there is an agent that acts differently from the environment. It sees the states through an observation stream. It then takes an actions to see the effects on the world. And through the reward signal, it basically learns how to control the world with its actions and how to behave in a way such that it maximizes the long-term reward. And in order to explain how this agent works, we have to go through the states, actions, and reward signal that we used to train our agent with. So what did the car know about its own state? I think I have basically skipped one, sorry about this. So it could see its velocity in XYZ direction, its acceleration in XYZ direction. It also knew its roll, pitch, and yaw angular velocity. It also knew the load of each of the four tires. It got the signal to the direction of the tires with respect to the direction of the car that the car was actually going, so it was able to know at which angle it was slipping at. It knew how far around the track it had gone. And very importantly, it also got signals about the track ahead of it. So on the right, you see a small patch of points, 60 per edge of the track, and the center line that extend on the front of the car to see what's coming from in front of it. So these patches, 60 times 3, were actually used as an input into a neural network. They also correspond to the 6 seconds of the travel time. So as you see, when the car was coming close to that corner and it was slowing down, that basically the amount of time and amount of points actually shrank down. The first step in racing other cars was representing them in the feature space. While we explored other representations, we went with a very straightforward one, with two lists representing cars ahead and behind the GT Sophie with some maximal ranges. So we had the sorted cars with respect to the distance from GT Sophie front and back. And what GT Sophie knew about these cars is the relative velocity, relative position, and relative acceleration. It didn't know who is basically operating the car, whether it's another instance of GT Sophie and there was an opponent. It treated all these cars as opponents. With respect to the actions, the agent acts at 10 hertz, so that is a pretty slow pace at which it takes actions in such a high-speed environment. But for various technical reasons that actually worked for us, and was a very reliable rate at which the agent could communicate in the game, and was making sure that the actions are taking effect on the world. The actions that the agent could take were simply braking or throttling, scaled to the values -1 for braking to 1 for pressing the throttle full, and turning left or right, again mapped to -1 and 1. The major reward signal that the agent obtained was the progress that it was making along the center line of the course. So from time step to time step, we looked where it was projected to that center line, and the reward it got the next point in time was how far it traveled from the previous point. There was a couple of other rewards in terms of penalties that we applied to encourage the right kind of behavior that we wanted. First, there was a penalty, a small penalty for tires slipping on the track, which is generally a bad idea, for hitting the wall, and also if the agent has more than 2 tires off the edge of the course, which was consistent with how the game evaluated whether you are off course or not. Then these rewards were basically for learning an agent to drive fast. But if we want to put the agent into traffic and learn how to overtake other cars or prevent from being overtaken and being a fair play, we had to add a passing reward and sportsmanship rewards. So passing reward is basically a symmetric, simple reward that was added to an agent when he was making distance, improve its position with respect to the opponent. He would get a proportional distance reward. Or if the opponent would gain ground on the agent, he would get a proportional penalty. The sportsmanship reward came in the shape of the collision penalties, so they were added in order for agent to avoid colliding with other cars. So these are the set of rewards, like agent was obtained as a penalty when he was involved in any collision, when he was in the collision and bumped the car in front from the rear. And we added the 3 more penalties for the last track, which was most complicated, Cirque del Sarthe, when the agent was sideswiping or rear-end the opponent on the straightaway, and also when in the curve, when there was a corner collision and when it wasn't another car bumping a car from the front, then our agent was getting the penalty. How did we evaluate how fast our agent was? So we had access to a lot of data in which humans had taken the same car on the same track and tried to get the best possible time trial time that they could. So the top graph is showing the distribution of individual players' best lap times on Lake Maggiore. Horizontal axis is showing the best lap time that they recorded, and vertically is the number of players who fall into that bucket. Superimposed with orange lines is the number of hours that GT Sophie, using 10 PlayStations with 20 cars each, needed to achieve the similar performance. So after about 4 hours of training, GT Sophie could go reliably around the track, but it wasn't that fast. After around 8 hours, it achieved the performance of top 20 players. 20% players. And after about 24 hours, it reached the performance of top 5 players. And then it took around 10 more days to get iteratively better until reaching the superhuman performance. On this bottom graph, you actually see the 5 circles that show the top 5 human individual lap times, their best lap times. And under the circle number 1, you have the histogram of the GT Sophie lap times, where the policy was trained for like 100 laps, and then we recorded the distribution. So you can see that the individual lap time of a human was slightly better than the mean lap time of GT Sophie, of this, on this specific track. And that specific human was called Galerio Valo, who was also the winner of the 2022 Virtual Olympics. And it was only the one instance where the human data, human results came so close to the GD Sophie one. Here we show basically that it wasn't only the reward function, state, and action that was that helped us to reach this superhuman performance. We actually had other innovations with respect to the algorithm and with respect to stratified sampling that we had to use in order to learn different racing skills and retain them through the training epochs. So on the top left side, you see the training scenarios on SART, including the five full track configurations in which the agent starts with 0, 1, 2, 3, or 7 nearby opponents. So in addition to training the agent to drive by himself, we had to put it in a lot of situations in which it faces traffic. So here we have a basic scenario for training an agent, which took 20 cars, spread them around the track. Each one is controlled by our agent. Each of these red dots in one agent, we start them all, and they start to learn to drive. Eventually, they are so good at driving that they never see each other on the track. In other four scenarios, we put also an opponent behind the agent. Besides these full track scenarios, we also added specific racing situations like grid start, slipstream, and final chicane, where GD Sophie had to learn how to start in crowded starts, how to perform slipstream techniques, and navigate difficult chicanes. So this data was collected and stored in experience replay buffer. Then fixed proportions of each table was put in a mini batch that was used for training. And this was used as an input into the QRSAC algorithm. Here I will show how the agent has learned to do a crossover pass and how it generalized to a very complex situation where you will see two GT Sophie instances passing two humans in the same corners.
Biko, once again, a defensive move there from Emerald, but losing two, losing three position there for Emerald. Oh, and contact there as well, as I think Miazono got a bit of a hit from Greece. Greece goes up into P5. Here comes Emerald on the outside.
So you will see here that if you looked very carefully, there was a green and gray trajectories, which were different because each of these two cars were seeing a different view of the traffic that it was trying to navigate. And the red line was actually showing if the agent would be alone on the track, how it would drive. And it wasn't only enough to basically being a competitive. We had to balance the racing etiquette. So here I will show how it looked when the car is too aggressive and is colliding with other cars. And how it looks when it's too timid. So here the GD Sophie actually pulls the lead on the final lap. And even the announcer thinks there is no way to be passed. But somehow GD Sophie gets passed. And what exactly happened is that the GD Sophie hit the brake when the opponent gets side by side, and it makes it lose a position. So this iteration of Sophie was too timid. And finding a reward function that balanced etiquette and nerve was actually crucial to the project. But not only the reward function was important to promote sportsmanship, the opponents that we trained the GT Sophie against mattered as well. So in the graph on the left, we see when GT Sophie trained against only the built-in AI, it learned to be too aggressive. And when it trained against an aggressive opponent, it lost its competitive edge. So the opponent-dependent behavior is one reason why traditional self-play did not work for us in this domain. And on the right, you see the GD Sophie showing real etiquette in side-by-side racing where it's passing Yamanaka here. And it's exactly the same corner where in the previous video you saw GD Sophie being too timid and hitting a brake. Here it didn't hit the brake. It actually makes a clean pass and wins. So here, what helped us is like new training regimes and opponent mixture, as well as the sportsmanship rewards that help us make this balance between the racing etiquette and the competitiveness. And finally, here are the results. Here we show the July race results and the October race results. In the July race, we took first and second. We lost the first race. We won the second one, and we lost the third one with the double points, so we lost the team points against the humans, where in the October rematch, we won all the three races. We took the first and second place. We ran the fastest lap in each race and won on the team points. On the right side, you see basically how the lines of GT Sophie and other racers look like. You see the GT Sophie lines are very flat, while the lines of the humans start falling more and more behind it, because once the GT Sophie reaches them, there is no way that they can pass it anymore. Here are some driver testimonials.
It was really interesting seeing the lines, where the AI would go. So there were certain corners that I was going out wide and then cutting back in, and the AI was going like in the whole way around. So I learned a lot about the lines and also knowing what to prioritize. Like the AI into turn one, for example, I was braking later than the AI, but the AI would get a much better exit than me and beat me to the next corner. So I didn't notice that until I saw the AI and I was like, oh, okay, cool. I should do that instead.
And let me tell you just a little bit about production in this last moment. So we had in February till March this last year, the first test deployment in GT7. The goal was to make GT Sophie a fun race opponent that will be accessible to a wide range of players around the world on a PlayStation 5. So we had five car races at four tracks. Each of the race had four difficulty levels, beginner, intermediate, expert, and also if the driver was very proficient, there was a one versus one version with the same car. The difficulty of the level was determined by a faster car. The human would get a faster car than the GT Sophie, and that was determined by the level. So the feedback that we got from the community is, okay, we would like this to have a permanent deployment of GT Sophie. We would like to actually pick the car that we would like to race against GT Sophie, and GT Sophie is still too aggressive. So we went and worked on their wishes, and we came up with the first permanent release of GT Sophie 2.0 on PlayStation 5 and Gran Turismo 7, where the GT Sophie can now drive more than 340 cars with 9 dry tire compounds and is available on 9 tracks. And players can use almost any car in the game to race against GT Sophie. And if you have the PlayStation 5 and GT 7, we encourage you to try it out. We, of course, had to change the training regime to basically train multiple cars in the same network. We had made some changes, which I'm happy to tell you about more in the questions. Here is how it looks like. And here are the upcoming challenges. I know I'm over the time now, so I'm happy to take any of the questions.
Thank you very much, Alisa. Thank you. Are there questions from the audience? Please accept these flowers from us. And again, thank you. Let's give an applause to Alisa Devlich.
Thank you. Thank you.